Welcome to another Dr. Sadler Philosophy Forum. This time I've got a special guest on, and we're going to talk about comedy. So it was very, you know, handy that I actually knew somebody in the business, so to speak, and that's Micheal Connell, my special guest here. He's an Australian comic. I've seen quite a bit of his material, and he's clean, he's dry, he's very funny, and he's found ways to weave in a lot of philosophy without necessarily making references to it into his material. So I find his work really not just fascinating from an intellectual perspective, but also grippingly funny. Anything else you want me to tell them about you, Micheal, before we get started?
No, please. I'm blushing already. It's one of the nicest intros I've ever had, so thank you very much.
You're welcome. Yeah, this is. I kind of like this because for once I just get to be the straight guy, and I don't have to have any pressure to, you know, be engaging or funny or anything like that. I can put that entirely off on you.
Oh, great, great. I'm sweating already.
So, I have a whole, you know, set of questions that I want to ask, and you know, as usual, we open this up to the audience to ask questions through the Q&A app or through Google+. But, you know, one of the things that I wanted to get at, and this is kind of a big picture question, you know, we've got this definition that we use in philosophy of the human being as the rational animal. And that, you know, rationality is always a matter of calculation or working out means and ends. Aristotle, though, he realized, and I don't remember where he actually said this, that we're the animal that laughs. And that made it its way into definitions of human beings, the animal risibile. And it went all the way through the scholastics, who you wouldn't think of as being very funny guys. But they make, you know, odd jokes here and there. And there seems to be something really essential about not just laughing, but appreciating humor to what makes us human. And, you know, I like to start out with light stuff, so I figured I'd throw that into your lap and get your reaction to that, Micheal.
Well, yeah, it is strange that humans are the only animals that laugh. I read an article, and I believe they say, like, chimps and other primates make laughing sounds as, like, sort of warnings, and, you know, they bare their teeth in a smile as, like, an aggression sort of thing. And then you think it's weird how now humans sit around telling each other jokes, making each other laugh, and if yet we were a little less evolved, if we were a little more ape-like, we'd be like, those are fighting terms where you're exposing your teeth too much. This guy's got a problem with me. Yeah, it's strange. Was it Aristotle who said that humans laugh because we're the only ones aware of our mortality?
Yeah, I don't know.
I want to say it's Aristotle, but maybe it was Plato. But that's one of the theories of comedy. That's why we laugh, because it all comes down to we realize it's death. Right? Every life ends in death. We're all going to die, and so life's a big joke. Anything you do is futile, and yeah, it's going to come to an end. And animals don't realize that because they're not aware enough, and that's why they don't have jokes. And I like that theory, but then the more you think about it, it gets really depressing. So if the, yeah. Like, it's a good theory, but then if you came out on stage and you're like, hey guys, we're all going to die one day, not a lot of laughs there.
I think it depends a lot on how you frame it, because, you know, with your Stoicism material, I was really surprised that we were having some back and forth discussion, just for the audience, some backstory, Micheal and I, about Stoicism. And Stoicism doesn't strike me as anything, you know, intrinsically funny. But you've managed to take a lot of, you know, points from classic Stoic authors, not even necessarily mention them, but you're able to find ways to connect that to your audience and a lot of ordinary day experiences and make it funny for them. So I don't know, you could probably make anxiety and death funny. it, it, challenge.
Come with it. Well, people have. I know there was a comedian, Mark Watson, who did an entire show about mortality, about death. I wish I went and saw it, but I didn't catch it. But, yeah. I don't know. It'd be a tough thing. I think anything can be made funny, but some topics are easier than others. With the Stoic stuff, I think they're quite amusing because a lot of their ideas are sort of counterintuitive, and they go against like popular thought. Like most people think, you know, if you want to be happy, you have to get what you want, you have to go out and you have to consume things, and I'll be happy once I have X, whatever X is, a nice car, a big house, you know, a happy family. But the Stoics are like, no, happiness comes from within, you got to learn how to do without those things. And it's just, yeah, I think it's a weird idea, and having that weird sort of going, you think this, but actually it's this, there's good ways to make comedy out of that.
Yeah, it's, you know, one of the theories that they're it's kind of funny because they've got these very boring names that analytic philosophers have come up for, you know, with comedy, you know, the incongruity theory, the I'm forgetting what they're, it's the superiority theory.
I read another one, the benign transgression theory.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah. They have ways of making it very, you know, overly dry. But
yeah,
that sounds a lot like the incongruity theory, the idea that, and you know, Henri Bergson, who's got a great book about laughter, actually, thought something along those lines that when we're laughing at something, sometimes it's, you know, we're doing it to put people down or things like that, but a lot of times it's that some sort of shift takes place and we're struck by something, and it doesn't make sense anymore, and so our response to that is it's a kind of openness. You know, it would be interesting. I've never thought about this. What is it like being on the other end, being the person on stage and looking out at an audience of people laughing? Do you want to crack up yourself sometimes, or are you, you know, deadly serious while you're doing it?
No, not really. When I perform my material, I've heard it. I've said it usually 1,000 times over. So I'll be like, oh, this bit again. here I go. But a lot of the time, you know, when I come up with new material, so I do new material, and you know, it would be great if there was a theory of comedy, if I could work it out precisely and just write it, you know, like paint by numbers and just go, yep, I'll say this and that connects to this and that connects. And there's a lot of books on you know, out there that are like, you know, teach yourself comedy, teach yourself stand-up, and they'll have like joke formulas. And when I was starting as a comedian, I tried to follow all these formulas. None of the formulas work. Or they work, but it comes out with a sort of a corny, not quite thing. It's a very sort of, it's an experimental sort of thing. So when I'm trying comedy when I'm trying a routine for the first time, you just have to accept that some of it's not going to work. So I'll get out there and I'll say it. And some of it dies, doesn't get a laugh, and I'm like, oh, that's terrible. But then occasionally some bits do, and people laugh.
Yeah.
And it's bits that I didn't think people would laugh at, and then I'll have a chuckle, so that's good. But yeah, usually I've heard it 1,000 times, and I'll run through. Not that I don't enjoy it, I still enjoy it, but once you've practiced it, once you've said it enough and you've performed it enough, you get this weird thing where you're on stage, and I'm saying the words and I'm performing the skit, and I'm looking out in the audience, and in my mind I'm going, ah, that guy's trouble, this lady's texting, you know, I'll be doing two things at the same time. And then sometimes even weirder, if I'm familiar enough with material, I'll be going, on one level I'm delivering the material, on the other level I'm looking around the room going, ah, you know, watch out for a heckler here, you know, I'll make eye contact with this lady. Then on the third level, I'm like, I need to buy milk. I need to go to the shops. You know, I'm doing my laundry list. It's just, it's a weird thing.
Yeah, well, I can understand that. You know, I'm sure you're familiar with that, you know, 10,000 hours outliers theory that Gladwell that put that out. And there's something to it.
I don't think it was Gladwell, but I did read that book, and I was fascinated because comedy is one of those things that doesn't quite fit the 10,000 hours. Because when you're, at least certainly when you're starting out, you're doing five minute spots, testing materials. Any time you perform around town, you're getting up at a comedy club, you're doing 5 minutes of material, seeing if it works. Even if you're doing a headline spot, that's like 45 minutes, an hour. So let's say you get 300 hours a year if you're performing like every single day. No one's getting that. If you work it out, it's something like you have to do, what, 20 years of comedy before you reach that mastery level? So I'm not sure how it works.
I think some of it would be the practice, though, wouldn't it? Trying out jokes at home and shooting the breeze with other people and...
Possibly, but I don't... Comedy, this is what makes comedy so hard. If you play a guitar, you can practice at home. You can just sit around with a guitar in your room practicing. With comedy, your instrument is the audience. So if there's no audience, there's nothing to practice. So I do rehearse my material. I stand around at home, you know, saying the words, learning how the routine goes. But whether it's good or not, I have no idea until I actually say it in front of a group of people.
That's a really interesting phrase, that the instrument is the audience. You know, we don't normally think about that. We think of the audience as the sort of passive recipients of something. Can you do that with a crowd as it gets bigger and bigger and bigger?
What do you mean? Make it...
Well, I mean, you talk about looking around the room and you can make a fairly personal connection with a small crowd. But let's say you were doing a big amphitheater, and comics talk about this. They come out on stage and all they see is lights, you know?
Yep.
They can't actually see the audience. They can't tell who's there, or I mean, if somebody throws something, I suppose they can tell where that's coming from.
You're saying, how do I make a connection with it with a large crowd?
Yeah.
Well, comedy is kind of an illusion. So the illusion is that I'm just making it up. It's the opposite of, I suppose, like, I guess, like, magicians come out and they do things and it looks like they've rehearsed it a lot and they've practiced it and you're like, wow, how do they make doves fly out of their pockets and all that sort of thing. Whereas with comedy, it's incredibly rehearsed, but when you perform it on stage, it should look like you're just, it's just happening. This is just something I'm saying off the top of my head. It's this fake spontaneity. And there's all these sort of little tricks that you can do. When I'm rehearsing, I'll often rehearse saying and ah in various different places. Not a whole lot, but just a little bit, just to look like that I haven't actually, you know, I haven't learned the material enough. But I have. I've written and R into, you know, if you held up the piece of paper that I've learned it from, I've got and R and you know and all these slang sort of expressions, and there's all sorts of things. You know, you make a lot of eye contact with people. Some of it obviously is improvised in the moment, but you know when the improvisation's coming up. So yeah, it's a weird thing that you with comedy you don't have that fourth wall like in theatre. You're back and forth with the audience, and even with a huge crowd, you can still sort of interact with them, and it makes it feel like, oh, you know, people come see the show, and they're like, oh, I can't believe he did that, that's amazing, and then they'll come see the next night, and they're like, oh, it was exactly the same. He did almost word for word. Even that bit where he spilled the water on the chair, he did that exactly at 25 minutes into the show, and he did that last night. You know, they're deceived, right?
Yeah.
But it's a good thing, and people argue that, like, I've never done a show this big, but, you know, some of the really famous comedians, they do arena sort of performances,
yeah, yeah.
You know, in gigantic stadiums, and some people argue that once you get to sort of an arena size, the experience is sort of destroyed, right? The comedian can't have that same sort of connection with the crowd because the crowd is so ridiculously huge. But you know, look, that's a great problem to have. I hope one day I'm struggling with connecting with all these hundreds of thousands of fans.
Yeah. Well, I certainly hope that someday you are filling an arena because I like the routines that I haven't seen all of your material. I'd say I've probably seen at least 2/3 of the stuff that you've got available on YouTube. This is a good chance, too, to put in a plug. Micheal has a lot of bits available on his YouTube channel, and the link is in my event page for this. It's really funny stuff, and so if you haven't had a chance to see it, take a look at it after this is over. Give him your full attention right now. But yeah, it's this is kind of a good segue into one of the things I wanted to ask you about. So there's doing comedy on the stage part, and then there's the rehearsal before that, but then you also have, how do you come up with the jokes in the first place?
Every comedian is different. I don't know if there's one set way to do it, so I can only tell you what I do. I often think that when you try to be funny, it doesn't come off as funny, it comes off as corny, right?
Yeah.
So, like when your dad goes, hey, here's a really funny joke, and you just see it coming from a mile away, and you're like, oh, dad, what are you going to, you know, don't do it. So what I've found is when I've made people laugh is not because I've gone, I'm going to tell them something really funny. I've gone, look, this is something I feel very strongly about, so I have an emotional response to something. You know, I'm really scared of spiders. I got treated rudely at the supermarket, something like that. And I'll tell my friends about it. And because I'm so passionate about it, I feel so strongly about this incident, I'll tell them about it. And as I'm telling them about it, comedy comes out as sort of a byproduct.
Okay.
So when I develop material, what I'm doing is rather than aiming to be funny, I'm aiming to express my emotions about a particular topic. It's sort of like, you know, like when you shoot an arrow, I think the Stoics talk about this as well, you shoot an arrow well above the target and it'll come down and hit the target, yeah?
Yeah, so that is the Stoic.
Yeah, I aim for, you know, to express my idea about how annoyed I am at the bank closing at 4 o'clock when I can only get there at 4:30, and then somehow, bam, comedy comes out of that.
Okay.
Yeah, that's basically my idea. But a lot of it, that's the very early stages. I'll work it, I'll write it out. I use a dictaphone a lot, very old school.
Okay.
I have like an actual cassette tape dictaphone, and I stand there, I talk to myself, and then I'll notate it out, transcribe it word for word. And then there's a lot of workshopping, editing, and then I'll get to a stage where I think, this is kind of good enough, and I'll perform at an open mic, and then I'll listen back to people's responses, and hopefully, usually it's around like, you know, 60%, 70% of the jokes are good. I keep those jokes, get rid of the other stuff, just keep refining and working on it.
That's really interesting because, you know, I end up watching, you know, not a ton, but quite a few interviews with comics just because I like humor so much. And they'll talk about the need to be able to, even after they've, you know, made it pretty big, to go out there and do open mic shows. And that helps to keep them fresh. So, you know, what you're saying would make perfect sense in there. Because you need the other people as a sounding board. Otherwise, isn't there a tendency to, you know, I would imagine if you start making it big, you start thinking everything that you say is funny, or worse, that none of it is funny at all. That would, yeah, be another interesting predicament. Go ahead.
Have you seen Jerry Seinfeld's documentary Comedian?
No, I haven't.
That is fascinating. He, at the end of his sitcom, Seinfeld, it wraps up, and he does a special called I'm Telling You for the Last Time. So basically he performs, he's got an hour of material that he's honed over, I don't know, 20 years. He performs it for the last time. He goes, that's it, I'm never performing it again. And then in this documentary called Comedian, he goes around performing at open mics, trying to develop new material. And it's amazing because you see him coming out. He comes out on stage and the audience is like, oh, it's Jerry Seinfeld. And then he's like, okay, new material. And so a lot of it doesn't work. And he's like, yep, doesn't, you know, that's new material. I got to try it again. I got to work it down, edit it up, change it around. But you watch him over a year constantly going out, doing these open mics, trying new material, testing it out, workshopping it, editing it, refining it, improving it. By the end of the year, he's developed a complete new hour. It's amazing. He's performing everywhere. But that's all part of it. You have to get that audience response. There's another comedian in England, Stephen Merchant. He says he wishes there was a device like a breathalyzer that you could just say jokes into and then give you a green light or a red light. Yeah. So far, nothing like that has been invented.
Do you think that, I mean, humor is somewhat context dependent. You can't tell the same sort of joke to somebody at a funeral that you can, you know, on New Year's Eve at a party or something like that. But do you think that some of it is always going to be, you know, so purely subjective that you couldn't possibly plan it?
Probably. But comedians aren't looking for that sort of material. You know what I mean? Where comedians, no joke will work for all crowds, but as a comedian, I'm trying to develop material that works for most crowds most of the time. So I'm sure, yeah, there are heaps of jokes that would only work in certain circumstances to certain audiences, but I'm too lazy trying to develop a routine for every single audience. I just want one that works most of the time.
Yeah. Do you think that you're at an advantage with telling jokes to Americans because you're Australian? They've done these studies that have found that it used to be that, you know, you'd put someone with a British accent and they'd get automatic trust in a commercial or things like that. Now it's right. Australian.
Really?
There's something about it. So we see a lot of commercials now where, for no reason whatsoever, there's a guy who's got an Australian accent describing a product. Yeah.
Wow, I don't think of the Australian accent as particularly trustworthy. Or it's interesting. The Australians have... I don't know. We have this weird reaction to other Australians. When in Australia, when sometimes this happens, you see like the Melbourne Comedy Festival. It's a big comedy festival. You get comedians from all over the world coming and performing, and guys from England will come out, and Australian audiences will be like, "Oh wow, he's English. He's come all the way from England. He must be amazing, right?" Or an American comedian will come out, they go, oh, he's all the way from America, he must be amazing, right? And then they're like, this next guy's Australian, oh, he's probably crap. Yeah, it's just down the road. And I'm like, why do we do that? Come on, they could be good. I went over to, I did some shows in England, and it was a bit different. Like, they'd be like, you know, this guy's from London. They're like, yeah, one of our guys. And I imagine in America, they'd be like, you know, hey, we're here in Austin, and this guy's from Austin. They're like, yeah, one of our boys. But Australia, like, also from Melbourne. I'm from Melbourne. It's like, the more you come to entertain us, the more we'll be impressed.
Yeah. I've got a whole bunch of other questions. Before I ask them, is there anything in particular that you want to go off on a ramble on, or something that struck you as funny that you want to bring up, or?
No, I'm hoping your questions aren't going to be too hard. I just want to let people at home know that I haven't studied. I've studied philosophy, but not in any formal way. I haven't done a university degree, and I know if you watch one of my routines, I say I have got a university degree, but I'm a big liar. That's just for a joke. So I hope your questions aren't too hard.
Well, that's quite all right. I think your routines are you know, well informed by philosophy, and you know, I think that there's plenty of people who graduate with philosophy degrees that don't actually know anything about philosophy, even at the graduate level, believe it or not. I've worked with a few of them. That's probably not a good thing to say, but so here's...
the things I have done, I've done an arts degree, and I rarely act anymore. Teaching degree, which I've never used. It's terrible. I should use all these things, but, you know... It happens. Sometimes you just go, oh, you get halfway through the course, halfway through the degree, and you're like, you know, I'm several $1,000 in, I've got to go through to the end or I've wasted my money. But then, some fallacy, maybe I should have pulled out and just gone, no, I'm going to do half a university degree.
Well, they don't give you anything for that. They
nothing.
I don't think they have a designation for that.
Yeah.
So let me ask you two sort of bookended questions, and you can take whichever one you want first. One of the ones that I've got is who are your favorite philosophers to read and think about, and what do you like about them? But then I also want to know, who are your favorite comics? Who are the people that you look up to or study and say, that, you know, he's really got something there that I need to pay attention to?
Right. Favorite philosophers I'll start with, because that's easier, because I haven't read enough to have a huge... I'm very interested in the Stoics. I love their sort of writings. Epictetus, Marcus Aurelius, Seneca comes out with good stuff. I think probably Epictetus is my favorite, but Marcus Aurelius, he writes some really good stuff. He writes some very funny stuff, I think it's very funny, at least. I love his, in the meditations, he talks about, you know, premeditation of evil. Think about, you know, you're going to meet with all these people who are going to be rude and selfish and inconsiderate, and prepare yourself for the day. And I'm like, man, you are so right, Marcus. Seneca's great. On the Shortness of Life, brilliant letter. Aside from the Stoics, I haven't done a whole lot of reading. I like Nietzsche, however you say his name. I hear people say it differently each time. I like the existentialists, Sartre, but they're very hard to read. It's very dense. I watch a lot of, Alain de Botton. He does a lot of introduction to, and, you know, Nietzsche for Idiots, those sort of books I'm reading, and I'm like, yeah, you know, this guy's got something going on. It's very interesting ideas. But then I'll sit down and try to read Thus Spoke Zarathustra, and I'm like, I can't get through this. It's dense, right? I also like Slavoj Žižek. Very, very interesting, got a lot of pop culture references and stuff going on. I'm not sure if he's a genius or crazy or a little of both, But he's a great presenter, and he's a great philosopher. Very interesting stuff.
Yeah, he's been turned into some comedy stuff. I don't know if have you seen the Cut the Balls video?
Yes. He's got, there's whole lots of bits in his lectures that people just love super cutting and putting together, and it just lends itself to it. I haven't really got anything useful from Zizek, because he's already quite amusing. There's no work for me to do there. Whereas, you know, like Epictetus, he's really tough and serious, and I'm like, he can be my straight man, and I can turn that into comedy. As for comedians who I like, I love so many comedians. There's so many great guys out there. I'm a big fan of Brian Regan, if you know Brian Regan.
Yeah.
Patton Oswalt, Bill Burr, Jerry Seinfeld. Just so many guys, In going the English side of stuff, I love Eddie Izzard, Billy Connolly. I listened to a whole lot when I was getting started. Too many. Will Anderson, if you're looking for Australian guys, Adam Hills is great. But yeah, I mean, it's come to Melbourne, come to our comedy festival. There's 1,000 guys out there. They're all performing great stuff. I'm doing gigs with them all the time. So many good comedians.
How long does that festival go on for?
The festival goes for about a month. It's too long.
Wow.
Honestly, it's too long. You'll see the first week is like a huge party for the comedians. They're all drinking and, you know, living off, you know, McDonald's and KFC, and by the end of the fourth week, everyone's like, oh, they're drained of vitamin C, they got scurvy. At the end of the season, it's always like festival flu, and we're all, you know, just ruined physically, but it's a good time.
It's sort of like we have these big philosophy conferences, and this happens in other things, too, in like the medieval conference in Kalamazoo, and you'll go, and these only usually last about a week, but you know, you go and there's all these other people doing what you do, and they're interested in the minutia of the things that you're interested in, so you get there very charged up, and you're like, ah, this is so great, I got to meet this person, and I got to go to this panel and this panel, and then, you know, by about 3 days in, you're like, I got to go to this panel. I don't, you know, it's really important. Maybe I can just email them and get the paper, but then I might miss something. And then by the very end, it's still good to have gone, but your energy level is completely depleted, and you're like, that's enough medieval philosophy for a year.
Do you, when the festival's on, there's something like 500 shows, and I know probably, 95% of the comedians performing, and you always see them at the bar, and they're like, oh, come see my show. And you're like, I can't promise to see any shows. If I promise to see one show, then I've got to see everything. Is it the same for philosophers? You're like, oh, I can't, no guarantees. I'll try and make it, but if I can't get to the lecture, don't be offended.
Well, that's kind of an interesting question, because with some of the conferences, that wouldn't be an issue because there's just so many people. When I go to the American Philosophical Association, there might be, several thousand people there. And if I go to one of the regional political science associations, because they do political theory, there'll be even more. And so you couldn't possibly know all these people. But it does seem that they always do manage to schedule the things that at least I want to go to all at the same time. So then you go to these smaller conferences, and they're very, they're very intimate. There might be only 100 people at the conference presenting or discussing things, and they'll have two or three tracks set up with concurrent sessions. And inevitably, the same thing happens where, at 12 o'clock, there's going to be three panels, all of which I should go to, and then the rest of the day, there won't be anything that's worth going to.
Scheduling.
I think that's just, but we can deal with that to some degree if people record their sessions or things like that. I'm going to ask one more question. We're starting to get quite a few questions being asked here, so I'll use my prerogative just to ask one more thing that I wanted to get on the table here. Let me see which. Oh yeah. So here's. I might have to rephrase this, but I wrote it down as, is humor something that we human beings need? Is it, I don't mean need like need vitamin C so we don't get scurvy. I mean, is it something that, is it a component of the good life or being able to cope with the crappy life?
Oh, yeah, that's a good question. People don't need it in a way like people need bread or water. Unfortunately, I often wish people did. Like, my dad's a plumber, and I'm like, you know, I'm kind of jealous of that because, like, you know, if your tap's broken, if your toilet's overflowing, you're going to call a plumber. It's not something you're going to debate about. No one's ever like, I need a comedian. I must. Got to get one in here. That never happened. But yeah, I can't imagine life without laughing. I mean, it'd be kind of dull and grey, wouldn't it? Certainly, laughter does get you through, you know, hard situations as well. That is a good question. I've never thought of it like that. Is it something you use to cope with difficult situations, or is it something to make a good life better? I can tell you, you know Maslow's hierarchy of needs?
Yeah.
Yep. I think every single university course I've done, I've done a lesson on Maslow's hierarchy of needs. But I do know that laughter is fairly high up on the pyramid, on the hierarchy. So people need to be fed and they need to be sheltered and they need to feel safe before they'll be ready to laugh. Often you'll get booked to do corporate comedy and they'll be like, we'll have you on while people are eating, you know, we'll serve the meal during your performance. And I'm always like, no, that's a terrible idea, because people, as soon as there's a plate of food in front of them, people's first instinct is like, I have to get fed. And that will always come before the laughter. So it's a higher order hierarchy, but I think it's necessary.
Okay. So let's take on some questions. Sure. That we've got here. Now, you'll be able to see them, I think, on the side. Here we go. So this is from my friend Leandro. Micheal, what was your best success in making humor from a difficult or uncommon topic?
Last year, I got semi-famous, internet famous, because I wrote the world's first stand-up routine about Bitcoin, which was like, I'm very interested. It's a fascinating subject, cryptocurrency, but so difficult writing a routine about it. I work on a TV show here in Australia, and it was about a 3-4 month season, and like the first day of the season, I went to the writers, because I had the writers and they're helping me, and I said, look, I want to do a routine on this TV show about Bitcoin. And everyone was like, this is not going to happen, this is a terrible idea, Micheal, you can't make it up. And that, before they said no, I was sort of on the fence, but once people tell me no, I'm so stubborn and obstinate, I was like, no, I'm going to write it. Now it's a mission. So it took me about 4 months of working on stuff and writing stuff and just reading everything I could about Bitcoin, went a bit Bitcoin crazy. And eventually I performed it on the show. It went well. But, it was about 4 months' work to get about 3 minutes of materials. But I'm very happy that it worked.
Is there other Bitcoin-related comedy that, you know, that has followed since then, or?
Not a lot. There is. I wasn't the first person to do comedy about Bitcoin. Other people have done like sketches and routines about Bitcoin, but like I would say 90% of the other comedy routines about Bitcoin is people. The joke is we don't know what Bitcoin is. What is Bitcoin? And like that's it. So I wanted to write a routine that was a bit beyond that, was going, here's what it is, you know, how it's useful, what it does. Yeah.
I mean, when people watch your routines, especially the ones that have, I don't want to say just philosophical, but theoretical topics, things that, you know, really you have to think about, they come away knowing something.
Well, yeah, that's sort of my secret plan to take over YouTube. I realized that no one... I just love comedy. I just love doing comedy. I'll just be funny about anything. It doesn't... The subject matter doesn't really... I suppose it does matter to me, but it's not essential. And I realized that a couple of years ago, I would be just writing routines, just whatever I thought was funny. I was like, okay, you know, my housemate is kind of a jerk. Let's talk about that, and I'll write it.
Yeah.
But I realize that because of the internet now, if I'm putting routines online, no one's ever going to go into YouTube and type funny comedy. No one actually searches for that. Or if they do go funny comedy, they're going to get someone, you know, Patton Oswalt, Bill Burr, some, you know, someone right up there, one of the big famous guys. They're not going to get me. But what people might be doing is they might be going, what is Bitcoin? And then perhaps my routine will come up, and they'll have a choice between watching a serious video on the topic, or they'll have a choice and they could watch my funny introduction. And so hopefully the comedy is the little sugar, the sweetener, to get them to learn about this interesting topic. That's in theory. I don't know if it's working so far, but it's what I'm giving it.
Is the amount of work that you had to put into this, you know, Bitcoin routine to hone it down, is that why that's the lead bit that you've got on your website?
Because
when I went. There's so many other things you can watch, you know, because you have comedy ranging over a lot of topics, but if you go to your website, you're the Bitcoin guy, you know?
Yes, yeah. Well, that's more of a case of me needing to update my website. it was quite popular, and still, I think it's the leading thing that draws people to my website, so they're looking for information about that. So at this stage, it is front page of my website, but I am about to overhaul my website and make it, you know, there'll still be a button, hey, check out, here's my Bitcoin comedy CD, you can buy it here, but it probably won't be so prominent next time.
Yeah. Let me give you another one from another person. This is from somebody whose name is Class Imperial Agent. I'm not sure exactly who that is, but, what do you think about Jerry Seinfeld and Colin Quinn's show, Long Story Short?
Oh, brilliant. Loved it.
Yeah?
Loved it. Yeah. Very, very good. So Colin Quinn does basically a history of the world, and he through stand-up, basically, and he tells the story of I suppose, Western history through comedy. And it's amazing, and Jerry Seinfeld worked on him with it. I believe Jerry Seinfeld was the director for it. Very, very funny show, very interesting. I was kind of a little annoyed when I found out about that, because the Stoic material that I'm writing now, I kind of thought I would develop into a larger show. So hopefully all these little bits will work up into, you know, 45-minute, hour comedy show about Stoic philosophy or the ancient Greek philosophy or something like that. And once I watched Colin Quinn do Long Story Short, I was like, someone else has done, not the same sort of thing, but he does a whole section about the ancient Greeks, a whole section about the ancient Romans, And I'm like, if I do this now, everyone will be like, he's ripping off Colin Quinn. So,
you'd have to have something to do it differently then, you know?
Exactly. I wanted to be more like, here's how you can use Stoic philosophy in your everyday life, less about, you know, here's the life story of Epictetus in a comedy reason. I'm sure I'll still have to include some of that to explain the ideas, but it won't be as much of the show now. But yeah, it's a great show. Long story short, I highly recommend it.
That actually reminds me of something I was thinking about earlier that I was going to ask you about. Aristotle talks about this emotion that it's the Greek word for it is zelo, so we translate that sometimes as zeal, but it usually gets translated as emulation. And he calls it a pain that a good person feels at seeing a better person who's like further along, you know, and it could be with one's craft, you know, like somebody writes an article in philosophy on, say, St. Anselm, somebody I research, I'm like, man, I wish I would have written that article, you know, and you're not detracting from them, you're not saying, oh, they're terrible because they wrote that article, that's envy, right, that's something very different, but you do feel a sense of, like, pain, not shame, not anything else, but like, oh, I wish that was me, you know?
Yeah.
And Aristotle, it's interesting. He says that's a sign of good character.
Oh.
Because, you know, other people feel envy. They're like, well, that's no good because I didn't do it, you know? Aristotle says, well, you're able to recognize the greatness of what somebody else did, and you just weren't there at the right place at the right time. I know I've had that feeling an awful lot with the kind of work that I do.
I feel that all the time in comedy. I'm always going to comedy shows and someone will do a bit and I'm like, oh, that is genius. And that's the sign of a good bit when you go, oh, why didn't I write that? Like, it's once someone says it, it's obvious, but until someone says it, it's really hard to grasp. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's another, that's a good way to put it. Comedy is very contingent. There's an obviousness or a necessity to it after it's actually been done, just like a great work of art or a great piece of music. But when you're puttering around with your, you know, your guitar, and you're saying, I got to come up with something great, it's not quite so easy to do that. You know, things have to somehow align, and then only afterwards can you say, oh yeah, this had to follow this. This thing that I said here just had to go along with this.
I like theory of art, and I don't know who said this, that I wish I could remember, but it's perfection is not when you can't add anything more, it's when nothing else can be taken away. So it's that idea of that minimalism, the less you have, the better, the more simple and precise the routine can be, the better. And sometimes I'll have material on a topic, and it's okay, it's not bad, but then I'll see some other guy do it, and it's just you know, the absolute, there's no fat on the material, it's just trimmed to the bone, just laughs, and you're like, oh, amazing, what am I doing, why am I bothering, this guy, he's got it all, you know?
Yeah. You know, you have a joke, actually, that touches on that. And it's one that's not on the Stoics. You have that one on Plato's, on his Phaedrus, and the chariot metaphor.
I don't know. Yes.
There's a line in there where you're going through, and this is this, and this is this, and this is this. And then you get to the wheels, and you say, the wheels, they're just wheels. Not everything's a metaphor. And that brings it together, you know, perfectly at that moment.
Thanks. Sometimes I'll be looking through the routine as I've written it, and I'll say, okay, there's too many setups. I've got to have a punchline here. I've got to have a joke. There's got to be a laugh. Because if you're waiting too long, people get bored. They're just watching it. And now that I'm going into this more, you know, teaching stuff or explaining theoretical ideas with comedy, that's much more of a challenge. It used to be like, oh, if I'm if I had a section in the routine where I'm just talking and there's no real jokes, I'm just like, no, I'll just cut it. I can just lose it. That bit in the chariot, explaining the chariot metaphor, it was quite difficult. I remember writing that, and it was like, oh, this is this metaphor for this metaphor, and the wheels, they're just the wheels. And I was like, oh, great, I've got a laugh in there. Phew. It's not 3 minutes of me explaining metaphors and then getting to the comedy. It's got to be comedy all through.
Yeah. I think I actually recommended that one to some of my Intro to Philosophy students a while back.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I'm glad that's happening. So I'm hoping that, you know, I'll do these philosophy bits and people such as yourself will start going, hey, check this out. If you're studying philosophy, you might be interested in this.
Yeah, you know, I don't think there's anything out there like that. I remember years ago when the internet was fairly new, there was a philosophy and humor page, and it was just terrible because it was, you know, it was the old internet too, so it was all these, you know, just link, you know, after link after link on some yellow background.
He's dancing Plato or something.
there wasn't much of anything, and it was pretty hard to find, but yeah, let me give another question to you.
Sure.
This one is from Andy. What are the topics or subjects you won't cover in your routines, and how do you make those decisions? Is it based on comfort level, your own commitment to ethics, etc.? Is there anything, you know, fair game?
I don't believe in censorship. I believe in free speech. I think you can make anything funny. It's not so much, but what I think is, it's not so much what I think is right to talk about or what I want to do. It's more, comedy is a business for me, and it's so the audience is my customers, and if I'm doing material that the customers don't like, then I'm kind of hurting my business, aren't I?
Yeah.
So it's more of a case of I won't talk about this topic or that topic just because people don't like it. I also do work clean.
That's something I was going to ask you about. There were two things with that. So one is why, you know, there's a deliberate decision on your part to work clean. When working dirty would get easy laughs because, you know, anybody can just throw a bunch of swears in and get laughs. And then the other question, which is more of a theoretical question, is it possible to draw a clear line between clean and dirty humor?
Well, to answer the first question, because that's easier. Why do I work clean? Two reasons. Firstly, because I'm lazy. because if I develop one routine that I can do everywhere, then that's less writing for me. I know other guys, other comedians, they have like a clean routine that they do at like corporate gigs, they do on TV, they do on radio, that sort of stuff. And then they have a blue routine that they can do in comedy clubs, all that sort of thing. But I'm too lazy to do that. I want to come up with one routine that I can do everywhere. So that's why working clean there. And I also working clean, you know, if you want to get more the corporate stuff, the TV stuff, higher paid things, it helps be clean. Also, the stuff I'm putting on YouTube, like you said, you were sharing it around to your university students. If it was a bit blue or if it was bad language in that, maybe you would think twice about sharing it. So maybe that helped a financial. There's a commercial side to it as well. The other reason I do it is getting back to what I said before about good art, perfection is when you can take nothing else away. So often when you're swearing, it's an intensifier.
Yeah.
And if I can cut those words, I should cut those words. But then the argument against that is that some comedians say swearing in conversation is how they naturally talk, and therefore they should be naturally saying that on stage, which is a good argument, and I would agree with that. But yeah, I wish I had a better answer to you why I work clean. Mostly laziness and being a bit of a capitalist. So there you go. Oh, second part of your question.
Yeah.
Where do you draw the line? I hear that a lot. Offense is subjective, and that's true, right? Offense is in your mind. Someone will get offended by whatever you do. But from a practical side of things, I just know that, I'm a human living in contemporary society. I kind of know what is, I'm socially aware enough to know what people generally consider appropriate, inappropriate. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And I'm sure it's just social construction. It's just something we have decided that these topics are not good, these topics or words are bad, and it's just an arbitrary thing. And I know other comedians will say that. They'll say, look, these words society has said are bad words. That's just an arbitrary decision, and let's shake people up. Let's get them. That's too much work. I don't want to fight against people's ingrained decisions. If people have decided those words are bad, fine. I'm not going to fight that battle. I'm going to pick another one.
Yeah. Well, something I was wondering was I'll get people, because I do these philosophy videos, they'll say, why don't you do a video on this? And why don't you do a video on this? And I get many more requests for topics and thinkers and texts than if I was shooting like 24 hours a day. There's no way I could actually do all of them. And so I'll say things like, well, maybe I'll get to that later. Or if it's something that I'll never get to, I just say, look, I'm not going to do that. There's plenty of videos out there already on that. And the reason why I can do that is because I'm already producing content on this area and this area and this area. And that's already, it might be a laziness factor on my part too. That's already a ton of work, at least for me. And so, people will say, why don't you talk about antinatalism? And I'll say, well, I'm doing these videos on Hegel right now, I haven't finished the Plato series yet. I'll probably never get to that. And I was thinking that maybe there's a lot, you probably have a lot of material constantly, sort of bubbling up that you could work with. And so there could be some topics that, in theory, you could get to that if you had 100 years, but you don't.
Yep.
So,
like I said before, I think any topic can be funny, but we live in a finite world. I'm not immortal. sometimes I'm trying routines and I'm writing stuff and I'm trying to get it across, and just people just won't go with the material, and I'm just like, look, I just have to let it go. I can't spend any more time working on this stuff that's not getting laughs.
Is that hard for you to do?
It's like killing your child. Is terrible. Yeah. This is another philosopher I'm a big fan of. Bertrand Russell. Mm-hmm. I'm a huge fan. I love his In Praise of Idleness. That was a fantastic essay. And I listened to that, and I thought, this is amazing. I'm going to do a whole routine about, how 9-to-5 job is it's a weird social construct, and it's like an artificial thing we do. But audiences do not want to hear that. There is no way. I'm sure there is a way to do that. There is a way to write that routine. But I tried for like 6 months at the start of this year and just could never get more than like 2 or 3 minutes of stuff about it. People just would not get on that train.
That's interesting. You know, Plato talks, he has Socrates talk about anything that we make ourselves is like our children. And so, you know, our evaluations of them are subject to the same sort of things you see people doing with their kids, where their kid is the smartest or, you know, the most attractive and never does anything wrong. And it's difficult for us to recognize that, let alone say, yeah, that kid's going to have to go off to the institution because he can't stay here.
Yes, it's crushing. Again, this is one of those things where I'm writing the routine, I perform it for the first time, and just the feedback, sometimes I'll write a joke and I'll think, this is the greatest joke I've ever written. This is amazing. They're going to love this. I perform it and the audience are like, not so much. And then I'll have a joke, and like, I think if you watch I do a bit with the harmonica, and that was just mucking around with the harmonica, and I go, this is stupid. This is kind of a dumb little thing. Whatever, I'll throw it out there. I threw it out there. Audience are like, yeah, he's playing the harmonica. So now I have all this harmonica stuff that I'm kind of indifferent about. My Bertrand Russell, you know, praise of idleness routine is just going nowhere. Kills me.
I've had things like that happen with where I do a video on some topic, and I'm not particularly interested in it, but it's okay. And then people are like, yeah, you got to do more of this stuff because we really love this. We're not interested in you doing the close reading of this over here. Yeah. Well, but students are like
the. If people enjoy it, then I start enjoying it more. So it's sort of a symbiotic, you know, feedback loop sort of thing. So, you know, I don't talk about anything that I'm not interested in. There has to be some grain of interest for me, or I just can't write the material. But I suppose there's a Venn diagram of, like, stuff people are interested in, stuff I'm interested in, and where they cross over, that's the stuff I can talk about on stage.
Let me put up another one that's being asked by Leandro that's sort of connected to that then. Do you ever add or remove jokes on stage, so in the process, as a reaction to the audience, or it's what you rehearse, no questions asked?
Well, when I'm developing the material, I'm definitely taking audience responses. So when I perform a routine for the first time, you know, if people have a weird response, I'll like improvise something, and I'm recording it. I've got the dictaphone put out there in the crowd, and I'll listen back after the show, and I'll talk to the crowd, and I'll improvise something, and I'll listen back, and I'll go, oh, that worked. That was a good improvisation. And then it becomes part of the act. And so I've kept it in there. Once the routine's developed enough, it tends to stay fairly set. But of course, you know, this is the thing about comedy, stand-up, there is no fourth wall. If I'm performing and someone heckles or someone drops a drink or something happens, then of course I'll react as required. But yeah. Developed material tends to be fairly set, but when I'm developing stuff, I'm playing around more. What I'm trying to work on now is my sort of crowd work. There's other comedians who have they're great. I have a good friend, Danny McGinley. He's an amazing comedian. He does a lot of warm-up work on TV shows, like he's the warm-up comedian before they tape a sitcom. And he'll come out and he'll go, you know, what's your name? You know, where do you live? And then he'll have a back and forth, have a talk with him. And he's amazing. And I can do that okay, but it's a skill that I think I need to practice more of.
What do you do when you get heckled?
A lot of it is just sort of being in the moment, just being honest with what's going on. Heckling doesn't happen nearly as much as non-comedians think. People who aren't comedians think, oh, it's happening all the time. I've been doing comedy, you know, over 10 years and heckled, you know, 5 or 6 times that were any good. Like, often you'll get people talking during the show, or they'll call out, like, "You're not funny." And you're like, "Yeah, thanks." Occasionally, if they say something really funny, you just go, "Yeah, hilarious." You own that. And you're like, "Great, I'll do that next time I perform this material." And it becomes part of the routine. A lot of it, you just have a talk. They call something out. You go, I often go, "What?" You know, I get them to repeat it. Like, "What was that?" And once they repeat it, you know, their timing's gone. They look like an idiot. You know, I don't like hecklers. They kind of ruin the show for everyone. But a lot of comedians are very they see comedy, they see stand up. The performance is more of a confrontation. So it's the comedian versus the audience. Whereas my style is more, I think the audience are my friends. It's sort of an interactive. We're having a good time together. So if someone will call out, I'll have a talk to them, I'll chat with them, try to get them on side. Usually it works. Or people realize what a moron this guy is, and then he realizes that other people are realizing, and then they shut up. So it's fine either way.
Yeah. We have something sort of like that in the classroom. It's kind of funny. I remember teaching at places where the students weren't the best prepared. And, you know, they would every once in a while they would ask questions. And some of the questions were really good, you know. And they, you know, you just say, "Well, that's a good question. Let's talk about that." You know, they have those what they call teachable moments. Every moment's really teachable when you get down to it. And then sometimes the questions would just be, you know, some of them were insane. And then some of them would be so basic, like, you know, what are we supposed to read this textbook? And some of the places where I would teach, some of the other students would, like, turn around and they'd say, "What's wrong with you?" To these students. So I didn't have to do anything. But most of the time I would just, you know, turn it into something where I could say, you know. At first, I used to get really angry. My first job teaching was actually in a maximum security prison. And the prisoners liked to have a good time. And they were actually really good students. I enjoyed it. But I was kind of a hothead and much more, like you said, confrontational, you know. I said, "You need to learn this stuff, and this is very important." And, of course, you know, they weren't going to take that sort of thing seriously. And so the older students like to watch the younger students ask me things inevitably that would get me angry. And apparently my ears would turn red when I'd get mad. And then I'd yell at them. And, it's very, you know, now that I look back on it, just it's kind of a really stupid thing. You know, you shouldn't be yelling at people in a maximum security prison when they're the prisoners, but there it was. And so they would just watch and they would wait for the inevitable reaction to occur. And it wasn't very fun for me until I started learning how to just, you know, let it go and, okay, we're going to roll with the question. It's not quite the same thing as a heckler, you know, because they're...
No, I have a massive respect for teachers. It's a really tough job. I developed a school show and I occasionally do like a motivational comedy show in high schools, and people always ask me, "What's the toughest crowd you ever faced?" I'm like, high school students every time. Like, I perform for the army, like you know, bikey bars. I'm like, you know, students. That's the tough one. But I'm kind of like you. When I started doing comedy, you'd be like, "Here's the material. It has to go well. I want to make it." You're trying to force an outcome. Whereas, and this is kind of a Stoic idea, and also a lot of other, you know, Buddhist, Taoist sort of idea, is that you have to understand that the true order is disorder. Embrace chaos. Yeah, understand that you just, whatever's going to happen will happen, and just embrace that rather than trying to force something to happen.
Yeah, Epictetus has this great line about, is a little oil spilled? Well, you know, that's the price. You know, if you want to have a nice jar of oil and a lamp and you want somebody to fill it up for you, then some of it's going to get lost, you know. I think they call that shrinkage in retail business.
Yeah.
You know, the cost of doing business. Here's another question by Jose Lopez. What was it, if there was one moment or several, that made you dedicate yourself to making others happy? That's an interesting question. Was it one particular moment or experience or idea that made you want to do comedy? Or was
I have a story that I always tell. And I always go, when I was a kid, I was in, you know, in primary school. They would have, you know, show and tell.
Yeah.
In America, yeah. So they had show and tell. And the teacher would ask me, would say, like, Michael, what did you do on the weekend? And I would think, you know, I could tell the truth and, you know, that would be kind of boring. Or I could come up with something more interesting. And when I did that and it started getting a laugh, I was like, that's it. That's what I want to be. A liar. No, a comedian. No, I tell that story because I kind of remember that happening, but I don't. There's never been a time where I've thought I really, where I sat down and made a decision. And I know that's weird to say. I grew up in the country. I never saw stand up. It wasn't really on TV when I was a kid. But when I was, you know, I always liked telling stories. I liked being funny. I liked making people laugh. When I was a little kid, I would tell stories and people would laugh. And then when I'd kind of think, that's what I want to be, like a funny storyteller person, someone who stands. And what I was describing was essentially comedian, but I'd never seen stand-up. It was like kind of growing up in the Sahara thinking, I want to float around on a lot of wood and dip a line in and catch animals. Oh, you mean fisherman? Oh, that's the word. So when I was a kid, I got into like youth theatre. I did a lot of acting, but I wasn't a very good actor. I was always trying to get laughs. I'd always go for the funny roles, or you know, or I'd make the roles funny. So I kind of ruined like a lot of Shakespeare, a lot of, you know, jumping out like being stupid. You know, and I thought I was good. I just didn't have any shame. I didn't have any sort of, I wasn't very self-conscious. So if they were looking for someone to be an idiot and run around and be a chicken, I was like, that's me. But then I went to like drama camp and there were kids who could like cry on command. I was like, I'm not an actor. I was in a youth circus for a while. I taught myself to juggle and unicycle and all these things. But again, I found I liked dropping the balls and messing the tricks up and getting a laugh more than landing the trick and getting it right. But then, yeah, when I was about 14, my mum took me to the comedy festival, took me to a show called Class Clowns. It's like a showcase of high school students attempting to do stand-up. And I went and saw it and had one of those moments, like we were talking about before. The MC was a guy called Dave O'Neill. He's an amazing Aussie comedian. And he did this whole routine about his dad cleaning their pool in nothing but his underpants. And I thought it was so funny. I loved it. I was like, that guy's amazing. If only one day, if I could be as good as that guy. And then some of the then I saw the student comedians, the teenagers doing it, and some of them were amazing, some of them were all right, some of them were terrible, and I thought, well, if they could do it, I could do it. And so I started doing it pretty much from then. I entered the competition the next year, stuck with it ever since. To answer with Jose's question here, he's put it that I'm dedicating myself to making others happy. I wish I could say I was that altruistic. Comedy for me is amazingly selfish. I go out and perform and I make other people laugh. And when other people laugh, I feel good. And I mean, it's great that other people get happy from that. I really enjoy that. But I don't really care. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm...
Yeah. It is a lot like...
It's not necessarily my intention to make other people happy. It's more to make myself happy. It's just that that happens by making other people happy.
Yeah. You know, there's something similar for teaching and for anything, you know, in intellectual life. I used to get very worried about, you know, I'd see students, they were doing terrible, and I'd be like, why are, you know, they're coming out of my class, they're not learning anything. And it would stress me out, and then I realized, well, I get to read Plato and Aristotle and whoever else I want to teach. I actually get to decide who I want to teach for a living. And even if they, you know, if it doesn't stick with them, I get to, you know, to talk with them about it. And that's, you know, pretty fun. So I imagine it's sort of along the same lines.
Yeah.
You know? If it works out that somebody else benefits from it, that's great. You know, it's not just a side effect.
Yeah. But, and look, if it wasn't making people happy, if people weren't laughing, then I wouldn't enjoy it. That is a horrible experience. So they have to be happy for me to be happy. It's a very codependent relationship, me and the audience. So.
Yeah. There was something else I was going to... I had thought about, but I can't remember what it was connected with this. Oh, yeah. So one of the things I haven't heard you talk about is sketch comedy. You do stand-up comedy, and have you ever done sketch comedy? Is there a reason, you know, you prefer stand-up to sketch comedy?
I have done sketch comedy. I've been in a few sketch shows. I've been in. I used to do a lot of comic acting, being a lot of comedy plays and theater pieces and stuff like that. The reason I don't do it as much anymore is. One, I'm lazy. Again, a lot of my decisions come down to laziness. When there's five guys in a sketch group, you have to meet up, you have to rehearse, you have to write the material. I used to be in a band, and that was crazy. Like, it drove me nuts because you'd ring up the drummer, and was the drummer available? Is the bass player? With stand up, I have complete creative control. I can perform wherever I want. I can rehearse whenever I want. It's a lot easier to do. Also, because I haven't done sketch as much, my skills have dropped off. I'm not that great at it. There are other guys who are much better at doing sketch comedy. I tend to think I should just pick one thing and go more for it. I'd love to have more time and muck around and do sketch. But doing the straight stand up takes enough of my time up that I'm too busy and too lazy to make it happen.
Yeah, I imagine it's not just time, but also energy. And the further you get into anything, I've found this, the more time all the things that go into it seem to just, you know, suck here and suck there, a little, you know, 10 minutes here, 20 minutes there, and pretty soon the day's over. And, you know, I've quit doing to-do lists because I never get anything done, you know. And writing the to-do list takes a good... 10-15 minutes anyway, so, you know, cutting that out at least helps a bit.
Frees up a lot of time.
Yeah, you know, not enough to actually get anything done, but let's take another one from Leandro, and I think this is almost all of the questions. So, it says, I saw you talking about economic inflation in one of your sets. How familiar are you with economics? How do you choose to talk about more serious topics in your comedy? That last one I particularly like. How do you pick which serious topics you're going to approach?
I pick my topics by going... I'm sort of thinking, if a topic's already funny, then there's... You don't need me to talk about it, right? The work's already done. So I try to... recently, I've been trying to pick stuff that is as perhaps, I don't want to say boring, but as serious as possible, that no other comedian has worked on. So this is again a sort of a marketing trick, or a, I don't know how you say it. It's a business move. I'm looking at topics other comedians haven't covered, and how can I do that? I know other comedians, like Patton Oswalt wrote a whole thing about praising Brian Regan. He said, look, it's amazing he does routines about, you know, airline food and the differences between men and women, but it's an original take. He does it. Patton was saying, look, he would think there's no way Brian can make this hilarious, and yet he comes up with new and insightful ways to do it. So he's kind of going that approach of taking topics that have been done and trying to do them better, or trying to do them differently, take his own spin on it. I'm trying to do a different thing. I'm trying to find something that no other comedian has talked about and come up with a routine on that. So rather than being, you know, coming up with the best routine on, you know, the differences between cats and dogs, I'm trying to go with the first routine on Bitcoin. So that's kind of what I did there. I looked for a gap in the market. Economics, I kind of went for, I'm kind of interested in the economics. I'm very interested in money. I understand even less about economics than I understand about philosophy. It's one of those subjects I think I should educate myself about. Perhaps I'm thinking after the philosophy show, perhaps in a year or two I'll do an economic show and get really focused on that and study it more. But I did try and write a couple of routines about economics, because again, it's got that reputation, it's the dismal science. You know, I thought that was a good idea, why not give it a try? And yeah, it's certainly something I might come back to.
Is there an element to this as well as, you know, there's nobody's done this, so there's the market, you know, niche that you're exploiting, so to speak. But is there also the...
Are you going to say the challenge of doing it? Because it's definitely that. Yeah. I was like, yeah, no one else has done this. How can I can achieve something that no one else has done. Yes, I definitely love that. That's a big ego boost.
I can understand that. What other so you're going to do more philosophy stuff. You're also going to do more economic stuff, I imagine. What other areas of seemingly too serious or even boring matters are you thinking about? You know, down the horizon, delving into.
Philosophy and economics I've got enough work cut out for the next, I think, next 5-6 years at least. What I would like to do, and these are vague ideas, so currently I'm working on the philosophy show. Hopefully, I'm doing bits of it on the TV show I do here in Australia. Live on Bowen, you can watch it online, Google us up. Hopefully I'll do that on the show, and then that material I'll workshop a bit, perhaps doing the Melbourne Comedy Festival in April next year. Then I'll be able to retire that material, and then I think I'll do the economics stuff. So that you're looking at 2016 for an economics show. But I've always been fascinated with Hannibal, the Carthaginian general, took on Rome, the Punic Wars. I'm a massive fan, I'm obsessed, but again, I haven't got any material, I haven't come up with a way to get into that, but I would love to do a show about that. Again, now that Colin Quinn's done his long story short, I'm kind of reluctant to go and take on Hannibal, but I would love to do something about Hannibal. I've also got an idea that I would love to do a kids show. I see other people doing kids shows, and I've like, has anyone ever done stand-up for children, like young children? Like, I've done I've written a comedy show for teenagers that I perform in high schools, and that was quite challenging because they have, they don't have the cultural references, they don't get pop culture stuff. I'll say, hey, remember playing the Super Nintendo? And kids are like, no. So I'm like, great. And I'm interested in thinking, trying to figure out a way to do a show for even younger kids, so like primary age children. Is there a way to do that? Perhaps there's not. But I'd love to give that a go. And I've also got an idea of doing a show, and this is really weird and hard to explain, but I've started doing a bit of warm-up work for TV shows.
Okay.
And that's a lot of improvised. You go out and you say, you know, where are you from, that sort of stuff, and then you talk to the crowd. I want to develop a show that has the illusion that it's all a, that everything's improvised as I'm talking to the crowd, but most of it's not. Does that make sense? So yeah. I'll have material that's already written about, hey, you know, what's it like being tall, rah, 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 and, but every show I do, I pick the tallest person and just do that. I mean...
Yeah.
Yeah.
That would... You'd have to have a lot of material handy, I think.
Yeah.
And sort of contingency set up. What if he says this? You know, what if he says this? Sort of like, yeah.
Exactly, and that's the challenge I'm kind of interested in. So it'd be, sort of be like a choose-your-own-adventure show.
That's what I was just thinking,
It'd be all it would be all about the audience. And that I would like to do in a sort of a busker, in a sort of an outdoor sort of situation, because I'm fascinated by street performers, how they get crowds together, how they control crowds, they're performing in the round, they're getting laughs, in sort of under conditions that a lot of comedians would find very challenging. And I used to think it was impossible. I think you could never do street stand-up. But then I read about Dave Chappelle, and his mentor was a guy called Charlie Barnett. And Charlie Barnett used to perform in New York. I want to say, is it Washington Square Park where they have all the buskers? And he would do, that was his show. He would do street stand-up. He would basically call in a crowd, tell jokes. There's like two, because it was in the 80s, there's not much material around, but there's like a two-minute clip on YouTube, and it's, I'm fascinated by it. How do they do that? So maybe one day that's the future.
Well, that's a good place to wrap up. I thank you for giving me an hour and a half of your time to come on and,
No problem. I've really enjoyed it.
It's always fun to talk about, you know, to delve into these kinds of things. I like getting to talk to practitioners of a particular craft too, you know. So I'm sort of picking your brain while we're doing this.
Well, I'm picking your brain. I've been watching your YouTube clips as well. You lecture on Stoicism, your stuff on Plato and Aristotle. I'm like, yeah, I can use this.
But you make it funny, so that's good. I'm a person who really enjoys laughing. So I've really enjoyed this. Maybe sometime down the line, if you want to do another one of these, that'd be great.
Yeah, I'd love to. Absolutely.
Okay. Well, thanks to everybody who's watched and everybody who's going to be watching this when it's not live, but canned. This will be available in my channel and also in Michael's channel. And we'll have links for all the things that we've talked about available in the video. So anything you want to say to bring us to a close?
No, thanks for watching. Go check out my website, michaelconnell.com.au.